This is a way bigger crowd than I was expecting, but in a good way, in a great way. So I'm going to keep the conversation fairly informal. I'm not a very structured academic lecturer per se, and I'm going to go through many slides. But I'm going to talk, of course, I'm going to talk about the partition, but also what to keep in mind alongside it is how can we archive the past in a larger way. Partition is, of course, a very, very specific event that must have only touched people, perhaps in the north and maybe south of Bombay. No one has been affected by it. But just think about the fact that art can transcend boundaries of even history and help us to archive the past in general. So, the partition. A single line traced across the land and lives of people is the pivotal moment for the creation of history. The line that divided Hindustan, India, into independent India and independent Pakistan left up to 14 million people displaced and 1 million killed, and these are just the official figures. It was called a massive exercise in human misery by the American photographer Margaret Bourke White, and yet us growing up in the 21st century have been basically removed from any form of even shadow of the partition. There is no public discourse about it. Until recently, there was no public discourse about it. All four of my grandparents migrated from what is now Pakistan. And despite that fact, I never looked at the partition with anything more than a cursory glance. And for the most of us, we read about it in schools, we read about it in colleges, and that's pretty much it. It doesn't really affect us, unless we are lucky enough to have our grandparents talk about it to us, or our parents. So, why the partition? Why did I talk of partition? What is this insatiable connect with the past? In 2013, while I was on a sabbatical from my master's degree, oh, by the way, I am an artist. This used to be my studio. It's beautiful. Now I live in Delhi. It's no longer my studio. But it's still an image that I love, so I should share it with everyone. In 2013, I encountered two objects that my family had carried from across the border, from Lahore into Amritsar and finally to Delhi. And something really strange happened in that experience. We were talking about this house. My mom grew up in this big house, which is in North Delhi. It's kind of falling apart, and this joint family lives there with 25 people. And we are talking about the house and the area and how it was a part of the rehabilitation scheme after partition. And my grandfather's eldest brother, my Nana's elder brother, he walks out of the room and he comes back with all of these objects. And they are, you know, old photographs and old books and bookends and little trinkets. And then two things, one of this, he keeps quite separate. So this one particular object, which is a ghada, it's a very mundane object which many people have seen in their house. He keeps this separate, and I ask him, what is this? Isme kya hai? Why is this separate? And he says that, you know, all of these things are old, but when you have to talk about the past, you must talk about it in totality with people and events and things and places. And this vessel, this ghada, is older than me. It was carried from Lahore into India. And my mother used to make lassi in it. She used to churn milk. And something quite strange happened in that experience, that he was describing to me the action of her churning milk, and an 87-year-old man became a 5-year-old boy, and he became, you know, he started smiling, he started remembering Lahore, he started saying, I used to run in an Anarkali bazaar, I was born there, and this happened and that happened. And I didn't ever understand before that the object has the ability to transport you to other places. It has the ability to absorb an environment or kind of contain a landscape that has now been rendered inaccessible by a national border. That afternoon, I traveled to Lahore. In his memories, we traveled to Lahore, and it was wonderful. And I didn't ever imagine that such a thing was possible. And that experience left me thinking that if one person is affected by the objects that their family carried across, I'm sure other people are as well. And so it began a very long and tedious exercise for me, mostly out of personal interest. I started going around Delhi, because that's where I live, asking people, kya laaye the? What did you bring? And at first, of course, this was met with a lot of confused looks, because some of the things that people had carried, as you'll see later in the presentation, was so mundane that people didn't even remember that they carried them. And they didn't understand why someone who was so young was asking such strange and pointed questions about something that was so old. Because the larger rhetoric of partition has been one of silence. And the question, the larger question here is, how do we, as the younger generation, connect to something that has been disconnected from us for decades now? There is no need to remember partition per se, except if we are looking at lingering traits in families and, of course, the rhetoric of violence that surrounded it. So why must we be connected, and how must we be connected? When I started looking at objects, of course, it was first of all to build some form of material ethnography of partition. What one carried across, how one took it, why one chose the objects that they chose, help us piece together some form of social ethnography of that time, help us piece together how people travel from the other side, what is precious, what remains precious. But then also, it is a nice way to enter into the conversation about partition. If I'm sitting with someone who has lived through the divide and I say something like, "Aapne Batwara dekha tha, you saw partition, it must have been awful, tell me about it." That's a very crass, very callous way to approach the subject. But if I say something like, "Oh, this ring came from across the border, it came from Sarboda. Oh, it came by train and your mother carried it and she received it in her jahez, in her trousseau. Can you tell me about the ring? Can you tell me about your mother? What did she look like? What clothes did she wear? What did your house look like? Did you have a roof? Where was, you know, the kitchen? How did you hear about partition? Did you hear it on the radio? Did you read it on the news? How did you migrate?" Now, all of a sudden, the questions become very conversational. They are no longer questions about hatred and violence and what you saw and what your family went through, but a gentle entry point into something that might be otherwise traumatic for people to talk about. And how would they talk about it? Right? For many years, the reason why people didn't talk about it was because they thought there was no need. I come from a Punjabi family. The Punjabi sense of entrepreneurialism is a great case study that came out of the partition. Many Punjabis that came from across the border came with nothing, and so they had to literally build themselves from scratch. And my family is testament to that, and I'm sure many of your families are as well. So there seemed no need to look back. That is the first generation. The second generation after that grew up with this anger. This happened to our parents. How could this happen to our parents? And so they started building this sense of anger around the word partition. And unfortunately for us, as the third generation after partition, we have only inherited silence. And imagine a child even younger than us, say someone who's 6 or 7. If they hear that something so bad happened to their grandparents in what is now Pakistan or what is now India, and they never talk about it, what will the child think? Something so awful happened that of course the Pakistani must be a bad person. So this silence is also a way for society to increase the prejudice about our neighbors. And of course it makes us forget that the partition was a shared event. It was a shared past. So if we are feeling some sense of loss, then maybe our neighbors on the other side are feeling it too. So I started this little exercise in Delhi, and it migrated very quickly to other parts of India. It migrated from being just a Punjabi story to being a story about mostly North Indians, people that were affected by the divide, the Bengali, the Sindhi, the Parsi, the Gujarati, the Rajasthani, Kashmiri, people that had seen the accounts of partition firsthand and of course had some material artifacts from it. And then I thought, okay, let's start writing something, because, you know, there comes a point when there is a need to do something. At first it is a social exercise, and then it becomes a need, zarurat, the word need. I was hearing things from people that needed to be heard by other people, and they weren't like, "This happened, that happened, my house was burned." It was things that were communally secular. Things, stories about Muslim families helping Hindu families, Sikh families adopting Muslim children. It's just about humanity, and it suddenly made the partition a very humane event. And what happens in the academic learning of partition is that you have these massive, colossal, umbrella-like terms, which mean that the singular individual that walked from one side to the other is just lost. There is no humanity left in the event. So I started writing. And I started writing a blog because history doesn't belong to me. It needs to be told to other people. And then I thought, okay, let's write something. It's great. I realized that I only had a one-sided perspective. I only knew about people that had come to India, not about people who had gone to the other side. So I made up my mind that let's go to Pakistan. And of course, everyone told me that you can't go there. It's so dangerous. What are you going to do? How are you going to speak to people? What are the questions you'll ask? But it's very necessary when you're looking at something like this from a new perspective. You have to get all points of view, because if anything, partition is a combination of different people's perspectives, different people's stories kind of woven together. So I go to Pakistan, and of course, the narrative is similar. It is similar, but not the same. It is not the same in that if partition led India to carve a part out of itself, then partition allowed Pakistan to exist. The very existence of Pakistan is contingent on the partition. The two-nation theory is married to partition. Qaid-e-Azam's two-nation theory is married to partition. And so it was the creation of statehood for them. And so the narrative surrounded that particular idea. But of course, the concept of identity is quite complex. And what I want to do is go through some of these objects to talk about that sense of identity and how it can be found in the most unlikely places, like mundane objects. This is on the cover of my book. It's my grandmother, and her family came from Dera Ismail Khan, which is now in the Northwest Frontier Province. It takes 2 days and two nights to arrive from the Northwest Frontier Province into Delhi, and they did so on August 14, 1947. My great-grandmother, who was a single mother, her name was Lajwanti. Lajwanti's husband had died when she was about 26, leaving her with five very young children. And so Lajwanti had been kind of shunned out of family property and not given her dues and treated very badly. But what she had from that family was this piece of jewelry that had been given to her when she was married. In those days, every woman that was married was given this. Mangtika was a very normal thing to be in one's trousseau. Lajwanti, with these five young children, travels to India by herself. She stays in a relative's house for 2 days in Delhi. And one day she overhears someone saying, this woman has come from across the border. She's come with so many children. We don't have money. We don't have food to feed them. In those days, if you had a house in the capital city, it was like a, literally like a refugee camp. Relatives from everywhere would kind of flock for safety before they could find their bearings. So she overhears this. And of course, she's a single mother. She's very proud. She's not going to have any of that. So she says, we are leaving. And she picks up her bag and she picks up her children. And she goes to Old Delhi Railway Station on August 16, 1947 to go back to Pakistan. Because this is not the life she signed up for. This, she doesn't believe in not gaining respect from people. She doesn't understand how someone can just throw around a callous remark like that. And she says, "Hum toh wapas ja rahe hain, we are going back. I don't care if we die. And I don't care if my home has a new name called Pakistan. That is where I want to go." Now, this piece of jewelry is tied here in the kurta, and she brought it specifically so that she could sell it. It would have got her a lot of money, and she could have educated her children. They could have found a good home. And so she's standing at the station with this thing tied in the kurta, and thankfully someone stops her. They take her to a refugee camp in Meerut. And many, many years later, I asked my grandmother, why did she not sell this? Because even if you were living in a camp, it would have still got you money and you could have gotten on your feet faster. And she says that, now this is just me speculating, that my mother had lost everything from her marital home. They didn't even treat her well. They didn't give her any money. They didn't give her any land. If she sold this piece of jewelry, the only physical connection to being married into that family would have been gone. And I don't think that she had the heart to sever those ties. So she didn't sell it, and it's still in our family, and in 2019 it'll be 100 years old. Jewelry was a very common thing. Of course, every piece of jewelry has a different story. So this is a very wistful, almost English story. A young woman called Azra Haq grows up with a Welsh mistress. Her uncle is the lawyer to the Maharaja Ganga Singh of Bikaner. And they, of course, grow up in this very high society circle of Jalandhar. And one summer, the summer of 1941, they go to Bikaner to visit this Maharaja, like no big deal. And so they're in this, you know, beautiful gardens and tea parties and all that. And the Maharaja is totally besotted with this young girl. She's 16. Her name is Azra. He can't pronounce the name. Aziria, Asia, he calls all these things. He just can't pronounce it. And just to give you some context, this woman was on the cover of the 1950s Vanity Fair. So she was clearly stunning. And she was stunning when I saw her last week at 94 as well. So she's beautiful. And they spent this wonderful summer together. And then at the end of the summer, her uncle asked Azra, "Ki Azra, what do you want as a parting gift?" And now Azra, of course, has grown up in this very particular society. She says, "I want pearls." Because pearls are a mark of elegance. They're a, you know, kind of a mark of womanhood. And the uncle happens to mention it to the Maharaja. And then the Maharaja, the next day, he sends this palanquin, this palki. And the palki comes with two bearers. And there are five young girls. One is Azra and her four cousins. The uncle has four daughters. And they all take permission to be there when the palanquin is opened. And it is emptied out on the bed, and apparently, as the story goes, cascading seas of pearls fall out on the bed with a note from the Maharaja that says that Azra can have as many pearls as she wants. Of course, Azra, being a very, very good girl, only took this one string of Basra pearls, which is incredibly rare. Now, many years later, when the partition happened, the Haq family found themselves in Dalhousie. And many rich families used to kind of migrate to these cooler climates during the summer for summer holidays. And Dalhousie was a very particular example because it was a part of Gurdaspur district. And from August 14 to 17, it was actually given to Pakistan. It was a part of Pakistan. So in Gandhi Chowk in Dalhousie, the Pakistani flag went up on August 14. And on August 17, it was taken down. Which meant that the Muslim families that lived there, who had thought they were now living in Pakistan, had nowhere to go. So this Haq family, this very rich family, gets this truck and starts to put all these valuable objects in the truck. The uncle has this collection of Persian carpets that are systematically rolled up and placed. All the furniture is put there. The, you know, silverware, everything, beautiful riches, they are all put into the truck and the family accompanies them. Now, as they are driving out of Dalhousie, they see that there are Muslim families standing on the street that have nowhere to go and no way of getting across this border that they suddenly are on the wrong side of. And so slowly all these objects are thrown out from the truck to make room for people. And so the Haq family carries people on the other side instead of objects. And Azra, because she can't find it in her heart to part with this necklace, holds it in her hand like this because it's small. And it's so discreet, and no one would ever tell her to throw it because no one would see it. And she, when I meet her in Lahore, many years after partition, decades after partition, she says that she's holding it in her hand. This is a black pouch, a black velvet pouch, and it's in that pouch, and she's fidgeting in her lap like this. And I ask her in Urdu, ki isme kya hai? What is in this? And she says, beta, isme to bachpan hai. My childhood is in this. And she says that this rare string of Basra pearls, which is so expensive now, it just reminds her of the grandeur that her life once was and how that way of life was just impossible when they came to Pakistan. Does anyone know what this is? In very old UP and Punjab families, paan is a very big thing. There is a box called a pandan which has all the ingredients to make paan. And by the way, paan is a very like particular thing to make. It's not like how we see it now. So I meet this woman that is explaining to me the ratios of the ingredients that go into make paan, and I'm thinking, wow. And it's very, very particular. So that is a pandan where all the ingredients are. This is a khasdan. It is an object which is used to present the paan to a special guest, khas mehman. So it's an object of cultural value. And now this scene is being enacted in front of me in Lahore, and this woman is telling me ke, when the guest comes home, the young woman must know how to make this tight small paan, put it into the khasdan, serve it to the guest, and the guest picks up this little thing, it's kind of like a French cloche, picks it up, takes the paan, says adab, and then has it. And I realized that this whole culture has been picked up from Hindustan and carried to Pakistan, and it's thriving there. And I realized that many women took such objects of cultural significance with them. Ye jahez ka hissa tha. It used to be every girl's, a part of every girl's trousseau. Kyunki ye tehzeeb ka hissa mana jata tha. It was like a integral part of one's culture. And so many objects like this were carried across the border because they were important for culture to thrive on the other side as well. Photographs, of course, people took photographs, but these are very particular photographs. I meet this man in Pakistan and he's telling me that his family worked for the Muslim League. Everyone in his family worked for propaganda, and he's telling me, I became a member of the Muslim League at the age of 5 when the membership fee was 2 anas, and we would go in schools and colleges to get people to vote for the cause of Pakistan. When partition happened, none of the family could actually go to Pakistan because they couldn't leave their home. The father couldn't leave the business. The mother couldn't leave her land. The sisters were married in Indian families. Him, this man I interviewed, gained scholarship into the Aligarh Muslim University in 1947. And he thought, okay, I want to go to Pakistan, but I also want to gain an education. So he enlisted into AMU, finished his degree, and then went to Pakistan. Now he's telling me, and also AMU is a very particular example because it actually contributed a lot in the creation of Pakistan. The students were very much for the cause, the Pakistani cause. And so he's telling me that all the time that I was in AMU, I was only thinking about Pakistan. Mera desh, mera mulk, my land, my country. And so I asked him, okay, so what was Aligarh like? And I expected an answer something along the lines of Aligarh was full of student slogans and the Pakistani flag, because that's what Aligarh was like. The walls of every college were just pasted with the green flag. They were slogans, they were students rallying because they believed in the creation of Pakistan. And I expected a description quite like that. But he looks at me and he goes, wait, let me show you what Aligarh was like. And if you can imagine this 85-year-old man jumping off his seat, running into the room. And he comes back with these 3-frame photographs. They are quite large, actually. They are about this big. And they are from the hockey club. It says Aftab Hall, Hockey 11. He was a part of the hockey club. And he says to me that, now this is a man that believed in the creation of Pakistan. He says to me that when I was leaving in 1953 for Pakistan, I didn't take any clothes, I didn't take anything, but I went to the common room and stole these 3 photographs. Because how would I remember my friends? How would I remember my India? Ye bachpan, ye dost, ye yaadein, ye yaad kaise rahengi mujhe? Jo meri mitti thi, the land that I left on the other side, how will I remember it? Through this. And that's when I realized that the Pakistani notion of belonging, of home, of being from a particular soil is really complex, because there is this veneer of the Pakistani identity which is almost impossible to crack. You know, you can't even in your subconscious talk about anything to do that's against the two-nation theory, because your country was founded on that. But I also thought it was very funny how he stole them. And I keep thinking of the empty walls he left behind. Carried certificates or anything to do with educational merit, because they hoped that it would help them get jobs on the other side of the border. This is a matriculation examination certificate from the University of Calcutta dated 1913. Now these two objects, the hammam dasta and Banarsi sari, they were carried from Karachi to Bombay by ship, and I think many people in Bombay have families that migrated by ship from Karachi or any part of Sindh. Karachi was a very specific example, Sindh was a very specific example, because August 1947 saw no violence. There was no violence there. It only began when the Mahajis started traveling, the Indian Muslims started traveling to Pakistan in the months of October, November, December, January, February 1948. These are the months that saw migration from the land which is now Sindh. Now, another really interesting thing happened at the Karachi port, that because Pakistan had been created and essentially these Sindhi people were a part of Pakistan now, there was a rule that anything that is a part of Pakistan will not migrate to India, including objects. So this is documented in newspapers and photographs of the time, that the Karachi port was overridden with objects that policemen had confiscated from refugees going to the other side. Anything from, you know, musical instruments to furniture to objects. And it was rare for someone to have carried something across unless they had some connections or were in the police or were in a very, you know, high-ranking family of society. So this one woman, I don't know how she carries these two objects across, but she doesn't even remember that she has them. It's in her bag, she has these children, and she somehow just finds her way onto a ship. Now, the really interesting thing about this particular interview, of course, the object is beautiful, you know, it's stunning, as is this. It's her wedding sari. But the really particular thing is that she tells me during the course of our conversation that the Sindhi language is dead. And I'm quite taken aback. And I ask her why. And she says that if we look at the word batwara, divide, partition, Punjab was divided between India and Pakistan, and it exists on both sides. Therefore, the language, the food, the culture, the traditions also exist on both sides. Bengal was divided between India and East Pakistan and later Bangladesh. And so the culture, the food, the tradition, the culture, everything, it exists on both sides. Because all these things are married to land. Sindh remained entirely in Pakistan. And so what the Hindu Sindhi carried were no traditions, no language, no culture, no recipes, nothing. Because the entirety of Sindh remained. And so language has not flourished because there is no land for it to be married to. And it was just such a sad reality, because it's true, the Sindhi language is dwindling and people are not propagating it to future generations. And I just thought that was a very beautiful and heartbreaking way to put it. Oh, this is one of my favorite stories. This is a crocodile, though it looks more like a ghadial because it has shrunk considerably. Now the story goes that in the 1930s, in Bharowal village in Punjab, on the banks of River Bias, there was a 15 and a half foot crocodile that only ate dhobis, washermen, that would come and wash their clothes. And I don't know, it was very particular, he only ate dhobis, and he had eaten about three or four dhobis, and the village people were very afraid. Now this one man takes it upon himself that I am going to kill this crocodile, and he stalks it and he maps its movement and he finally shoots it. And when he shoots it, he decides to carry it. It's 15 and a half feet, it's very large. So he picks it up with the help of a few people and he carries it to the village, and it is put on display. It is put on display for the families of those dhobis who have lost their lives by this river, and everyone comes and kind of looks at it, and children are poking it, and then it's taxidermied and it's skinned. And during partition, it's that man's prized possession. So sure enough, he rolls up the skin, he picks up the head, and he carries it to Pakistan, and it is now in a home in Lahore, and it's shrunk quite a bit. Because 70 years have passed now, and it looks actually quite like a ghadial rather than a crocodile, but it was quite fleshy to begin with. I touched its teeth. Nameplates. Old houses have nameplates like this. This says Shams Manzil. It was from Jalandhar. and it was carried to Faisalabad, Lialpur in Pakistan. Similarly, another nameplate carried from Pakistan to India many years after partition belonging to Bakshi Tek Chand. His house was called Shanti Bhavan. And these two stone plaques were actually carried by the family that moved into Bakshi Tek Chand's house in Lahore. And when they were demolishing the house, of course, the nameplate was still there. When they were demolishing it many decades after partition, they searched for Bakshi Tek Chand's family. And they were a well-known family because Bakshi Tek Chand was the advisor to the Punjab Boundary Commission of the Radcliffe's Partition Commission. And so they found him, they found the family, they tracked them down to Delhi, and they traveled to Delhi with these two plaques and gave them back to the family. And now they are in a home in Delhi in a room that's called the Lahore Room. Religious objects, of course, many people carried little deities. Many Sikh men put little Guru Granth Sahibs inside their turbans. Qurans were carried, small little pocket Qurans were carried across, because again, that was belief. You carry your belief with you. Another certificate. It is from the Northwestern Railway. The man that owns this certificate got a job with the Indian Railway System. Locks and keys. Many people thought that partition was not permanent, and they really truly believed that we would come back. So they carried things like keys and locks, and they left their homes totally closed up with all the objects inside it, and many went back to retrieve them later. I have an interesting story in my book about, everyone knows the author Gocharan Das? Of course. His grandmother, Shibdai Verma, did this very weird thing. She locked her house 51 times. Gocharan Das remembers seeing as a child this guchha of 51 keys. 51 keys. Because she locked the drawer, the cupboard, the drawer in the cupboard, the kitchen, the storeroom, the house, she locked everything. Because she knew she would come back, right? And what's more is that she employed a local woman to clean before they came back. And he says to me in Punjabi that this, my grandmother said, ki saade aan de pehle safai zarur honi chahiye. Ki before we come back, it must be clean, as if they are going on vacation or something. Because she was so certain that they would come back to Lialpur. And of course, they didn't come back. And all she had was these keys. And he remembers, he says, she lamented her whole life for these keys and that house, what happened to the house. But many people did think that they would go back, and it wasn't permanent, and they couldn't believe how so easily something could just be divided. You know, even the thought is kind of inconceivable. Trunks. Lots of people carried, of course, trunks with their belongings inside. And this belongs to VP Sondhi, who used to be the director of the Geological Survey of India. And just one thing, this paper is over 70 years old. I mean, it's just amazing. It amazes me the tenacity of objects of that time, you know, to kind of defeat time, as it was. These are the keys that opened the trunk, and that's just so beautiful, right? And that's him on the right. They all belong to his daughter, who now lives in Kolkata. Again. Religious books, Guru Granth Sahib, but this is a very interesting story attached to it. As I told you, many families went to cooler climates in the summer. So did this one family from Rawalpindi. They moved to Simla, and not Simla proper, but there is a small town above Simla called Mashobra. And they moved there. Now, Mashobra was quite quiet during the partition. There was not a lot of violence. And so how they learned about partition, because they were there for the summer, partition happened. How they learned about partition was through the fruitwala. Every week he went up to sell his fruits and vegetables, and he said, ki bibi batwara ho gaya. Partition has happened. India and Pakistan are divided. And that's how they learned. And this is August. In September, 1 month after partition, a man knocks on their door in Mashobra, and he looks like their neighbor from Rawalpindi, Roshan Lal, but he's grown his beard very long. And he says that I am going back to my house in Rawalpindi. I have put money inside the floor there. many people didn't trust banks, so they would put money and jewelry inside the floor, inside the walls, you know, behind bricks. I'm going back, I need that money. Do you want something from your house? And this woman is totally taken aback, and she's like, how are you gonna go? He's like, I don't know, I'll manage. So she says, okay, if you do manage, get me back my Guru Granth Sahib. And it's in a room at the back, the prayer room. If it's still there, please get it back. Roshan Lal, who has been growing his beard for a month, puts little kajal in his eyes, wears a karakul topi, wears a pathani suit, and becomes Roshan Deen and travels back across the border to retrieve his money. He goes to Rawalpindi, he finds his house, he finds the money also. And then he goes and knocks on the door next to his house. And a Muslim family opens the door, and this is kind of where it's important to realize that though the larger rhetoric of partition is one of violence and brutality, incredible acts of kindness, resilience, sacrifice, friendship did emerge from it as well. People did help one another. They did take care of each other, and they did take care of each other's belongings also. So Roshan Deen Urf Roshan Lal knocks on the door and says that I am so and so, I have come from Hindustan, and I just wanted to know, is there a prayer book here? Because a family left it behind. And this Muslim family said that there is a room at the back of our house which is locked, and we didn't have the heart to open it, and it's locked as it was, so you can look at it. He unlocks the door, he breaks the lock, he goes in, and that prayer book is sitting as it was, as if totally untouched by any violence. And he picks it up and he brings it to India. And now the woman who owns it in Delhi, she reads it every day. This is a portrait of Prabhjot Kaur, who is a Punjabi Sahitya Academy Award winner. And she, because she's a writer, she continued to write during the partition. And if you see, this says 21st of August 1947. And when I asked her ke bahar katleam ho raha tha, everyone was being killed outside, aur aap andar kavita likh rahe the, you were writing poetry inside, and she said that that was my way, that was my way of interpreting what was happening. The Quit India movement is happening outside, and I am burning my malmal cloth, and I am wearing khadi, and I'm writing about it. And I did many series of interviews with her. Maybe she is probably the only person that I did about 4 or 5 sessions. And in the last session, she was quite old. She was so old that she couldn't speak very well. But she tells me this one thing which kind of really shook me, and it shook her daughter who was sitting with us, because she had never heard this particular memory. She says that when we left Lahore, we were near the Badami Bagh Gurdwara. When we left Lahore to come to Kalyan near Bombay, we were told that a truck will come sometime in the middle of the night to take you to the train station. And we were all told to be ready, and we were given these black shawls. Us zamane mein na chadar kehte the, us border ke us paar bhi chadar kehte the. The shawl is called a chadar over there. So she says, we were wearing these black chadars, and we felt like, you know, we were fleeing, absconding our home, and it was shameless. We were doing it in a way that was shameless. And I remember I was making chapati, and the truck came, and I left the chapati on the stove, and in the whole truck ride to the train station, I kept thinking ki meri chapati jal gayi, and my chapati is burnt. They arrive at the train station and it's silent, and that was rare for that time, because in the days of independence, every train station was just fraught with mobs and people and rioters and bodies. And she said that we thought we were so lucky. It was totally quiet. We were lucky. We had lucked out. And there was a train waiting for us, and we quickly got on it. And the reason why there was nobody on the station is that everyone in the train was dead. They were just bodies. And I know it's disgusting to listen to these things, but this is reality. They were just bodies, mutilated and cut up, and blood was everywhere. And she recalls the black chadar, the darkness of the black of the chadar was not dark enough, because she could see a pool of red blood soaking through it. And now this is a very visceral image because she is a poet and she remembers these things, and she says, we sat on the bodies because we needed to get out. We are sitting on the bodies, we are sitting next to a deceased person, there are stray hair on the ground, there is a briefcase, but that was what reality was. And of course it shook me, but it shook her daughter even more because she said that, aapne kabhi bataya kyun nahi? And why did you never tell me all these years? And she said that there was no need. There was no need to remember this. But now it's important. And now it must be told. Even people of that generation realized at some point that these memories are vital for us. My own grandmother said to me, ask me quickly, quickly before I forget. As if I didn't ask her and her memory would just dissolve because of old age. And that is what's happening. People are forgetting. This is my last story, and then I want to open it up to questions. But it's a very important story for me because it actually brings literature into life. And it shows us that art is probably the only thing that can dissolve and transcend boundaries. A woman invited me to her house in Lahore to look at these Kashmiri hand-carved utensils. Things like this, very beautiful. Things like this, lovely, lovely. She also wanted me to look at zari that her family had brought. So it's not the cloth that they had brought across the border, it's actually the silver thread. And zari is very, very particular because if you burn the cloth, because it's pure gold and silver, only zari remains. So she brought this. But she really didn't want to talk about all this. You know, she said, she just mentioned it, okay, this thing belonged to this person, this thing belonged to this person. What she really, really wanted to talk about, and she did for a long time, is this. This house. She wanted to talk about this house. This house is called Kehkishan. Kehkishan means galaxy. Now, the woman I interviewed, her name is Sitara, and her sister's name is Surya. And this house was built by their father, Mia Afzal Hussain, who was the first Indian Vice Chancellor of Punjab University. He was also the half-brother of Sir Fazli Hussain, who founded the Unionist Party. She only wanted to talk about this house with green shutters in Dalhousie on Upper Bakrota that they had to leave behind at the time of partition. And as I told you, Dalhousie was a part of Pakistan for 3 days. So people didn't actually expect that they had to leave. Now she told me about this house, and I even asked her who lived in this house, and she said, I don't know, as far as I know, two brothers live there now. The only reason she knew this is because this is a photo of the house in 1947 as they left it. And this is a photo taken about 4 or 5 decades after partition, taken by a family friend who had gone to see his house in Dalhousie. As you can see, it's kind of unchanged. The family hasn't changed the house at all. Now, I wrote the chapter in my book and I kind of forgot about it, of course, because it's there. And I thought for sure it was the end of my association with a house called Kehkishan. 2 months after my book is published, something very strange happens. My family owns a bookshop in Delhi. A Sikh gentleman walks into that bookshop. And I think the only reason he knew about that bookshop is because I mentioned it somewhere in the book. He's reading the book, he sees the bookshop, he chances upon something very strange in the book, and he comes very angrily one morning to the bookshop. What is this? I want to speak to this woman. I want to speak to this author. And he quickly, quickly opens the book to chapter 17 that has exactly this photograph on it. And he says, what is this house? And I'm confused. And he says, this is my house. This is the house my family got in a claim after partition. Kehkishan Koti, Upper Bakrota, Dalhousie. And I just burst into tears. And I call Sitara in Lahore. And I say Sitara, but she's actually 94. I call her to hear the reality from this Indian side. It just fit. And they were telling me about how they took care of the house after partition, and it was very beautiful. And then because I am so shameless, I just invited myself to that house. And I traveled for 6 hours from Delhi with all the way to Dalhousie. And this is me holding up that photograph from 1947 with the house now. And it's identical, so much so that they've kept the original structure of the house. Kehkishan, galaxy. The house is built like an observatory. The main bedroom, the living room are built round like an observatory. There are small stars and moons carved into the house. It's very beautiful. Afzal Hussain obviously put a lot of thought into this house. And so this family, the Bedi family, kept it exactly like that, including keeping the nameplate. So everything became very real. This is the ceiling. Afzal Hussain carved stars into it. Now, because I was in Dalhousie, and because Dalhousie is a small place, and it was very much English run at one point, I said there must be some documents of the house. I've come this far, let's see. I go to the municipal office and I am sent into this room. And this man, this clerk is like, now he's like, and I'm only going to say this in Hindi because it's best in Hindi, he's like, madam, kuch nahi milne wala. No, I'm never going to find anything. And I say that I am not leaving without this file. He's like, madam, fir ghante ghante lag jayenge yahan pe. And I said, I don't care, I'll help you. So I start like literally taking out these files and quite frantic, you know, because this is my last day in Dalhousie and I'm going to find this. And in that moment, something dawns on me and I think to myself, why are you going absolutely crazy for someone else's history? This is not your history. This is not the history of your family. This is the history of literally two families that you don't know. And then I realized that, of course, this is my history because we have shared history. And these people are family because I've made them family. And so many of us younger people that are working in the realm of history do this. We adopt other people's histories as our own histories because it is important for us to do that. There is a void in the historical landscape, the younger narrative, and we need to fill that. And I was doing that sitting over there. We found the file, of course, because I'm so persistent. And it was like a rush because it said buildings of Mia Afzal Hussain. And it was real. And the plans were there. I mean, one thing I have to say, that buildings built during the British era are just, everything is there. You know, they are conserved. The plan is conserved. And there were letters, there was a signature. And I'm sending these to this 94-year-old woman across the border, and she is just so happy. Now, Afzal Hussain is a copious letter writer. Like, seriously. It's very difficult to build a house in the hills, and I realized this by going through 6 years of his letters about nalas and sanctions and servant quarters and the water pipes and the drainage and the neighbors. He writes about everything. But I realized that I'm piecing together this man. Piecing, literally, putting his parts together. He's talking about a nala here. For 6 years, he talks about a nala. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but he's like complaining that the water from the nala is coming into my house. And sure enough, the water from anyone's nala came to our house, we would also write for 6 years. Now, this letter is one of the last letters in the file, and it really breaks my heart. It's dated 12th of May, 1947. So, May, June, July, August, 4 months, 47. Basically, what this letter says, it's a letter from his builder, and it says that, can you please sanction us such and such time, because we want to extend the kitchen of Kekishan Koti. Now, 4 months before this apparent division, Mia Afzal Hussain is looking to extend his house. So obviously there was no plan to leave. And there was no need to leave. He wasn't going to go anywhere. He was going to actually build his house. And it really, really breaks my heart because they just fled. And so many people just fled. But the real reason why I was there was this. I Skyped with her and I've never seen her so happy. She didn't say a single word except for kuch nahi badla, everything is the same. It was incredible. She was so happy. And I give the phone to the Bedi family and, you know, because it's, yes, I have made this connection, but it's a very private, intimate thing between two families. And they are talking and they're showing her around and she and her daughter Shehnaz are like smiling on the other side. And then the Indian family, the Bedi family, says to them, ki aap apna visa karwa lo. You must get a visa. Next May, we will spend time in our house, the house that we share. And I realized that this is not an Indian family talking to a Pakistani family. This is actually two families that share the history of a house. And it's so beautiful. And I realized that though this work that I'm doing about objects might be really frivolous in some way, what did you bring, what are the things, show me your things, 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 things. I know how to say things in different languages. But, you know, it is a democratic space. The object becomes a democratic space to talk about other things. If I'm talking about a plate, an aluminum plate from the 1950s or the 1920s, and I post a photo of it on my blog, and a person from Dhaka, and a person from Shillong, and a person from Madhya Pradesh, and a person from Karachi are talking about that plate, saying, I've seen this in my house. Do you know that we used to engrave it like this? I've seen this, Kalai was done on this. This is a conversation, cross-border conversation, about an object, and it is transcending a boundary. The object becomes a democratic space to talk about other things. We are not so different. We use the same things in our house, we eat the same food. Sometimes we even speak the same language. So, I wrote a book, of course, please buy the book. But, more importantly, while I was finishing up the research for the book, I thought to myself, hey, wouldn't it be great that we could have... And the reason why I thought this is because many people started writing to me from different places saying, I'm from Pune, I have this thing, please come to my house. I'm from Kashmir, I have this beautiful, you know, shawl that my grandmother wore from Quetta, please come and archive it. And I thought that I can't always go to these places, it's impossible. But wouldn't it be great if we had a digital archive that people could write about their objects of age, not limited to partition, but in general, so that we can be proud bearers of our history. And you know, there's nothing more empowering than asking someone, where do I come from, and getting the answer and knowing and pinpointing, because at some point in our life we will have this weird existential crisis where we will say, where are we from and why are we the way we are. Sometimes last names help us to pinpoint where we are from, but it's not always that easy. We must ask the question. So I thought, wouldn't it be great? And I founded this digital museum with my friend Navdha, encouraging people of the second and third generations, or anyone really, to write about objects of age and antiquity in their home, to ask the question. So, you know, if you see something really, really old, like even these photographs, you ask the question, where is it from? And you write this small piece of 500 to 700 words, and we share that so that your history is out there with the world, and people can read it and people can relate to it. I'm bringing this up because if anyone has anything or you just want to look at it, please go to it. It's called the Museum of Material Memory. There is a submission thing. You can see it, blah, blah, whatever. I'm going to end here. This is my contact. If you have objects, and I mean the reason really for this talk is to encourage some form of collection of history, right? So if you have objects, look at them, first of all. If you have old people living in your house, talk to them, because really all they want is some time with people. They just want to talk. And I know it gets a lot. I know I spend a lot of time with 80, 90-year-olds, I get it. But you will be richer for it. You will learn something, for sure. And of course, the object is a great way to enter into that discourse. So if you have something you want to submit to the museum, or just want to reach out, or want to talk, or have a story, this is my contact. And I do want to open it up to questions now, and comments, and discussions, anything.